James Kalm, the guy on the bike. And we're here at 591 Broadway. We're gonna run up the June Kelly Gallery and take a look at some paintings by James Little. Take a little panoramic view of the show here. Unfortunately, I couldn't make it here for the opening, and I think today is next to the last day of the show. This piece is called Painting for Two Angels, 72 by 94 inches. And James is actually one of the more extraordinary abstract painters in America these days. He works in an encaustic slash oil technique that is very, very luscious, very sensual. He has to apply all this wax at about 155 or 60 degrees. And he says it'll actually burn your skin right off your hands. This piece is Gypsy, also 72 by 94. Now, there's a wonderful interview with James Little in the Brooklyn Rail. I think it's by Ben LaRocca. And James talks about his background and some of his ideas. He talks about how he was influenced by Clement Greenberg. This is Satchmo's answer to Truman. He's also talked about how people have tried to classify him as a hard-edged painter, but he doesn't consider himself a hard-edged painter. But if you look at his use of these bands, these narrow wedges, and the subtle contrast of these colors, a lot of ways, this is like chords. Instead of chords of music, it's like chords of color. This is When Aaron Tied Ruth. James says he spends 2 or 3 months on each one of these paintings and only works on one at a time. And they're very labor intensive. But I think his striping does play a different kind of tone, a different type of vibration on the canvas here. We've got some fans showing up. I also think James is one of the cats that is keeping the whole idea of a type of formalist abstraction fresh and alive, and he's got a lot of young artists that are very interested in his work and follow his practice a lot. This is the marriage of Western civilization and the jungle. I've been badgering James to come by and do a studio visit. Maybe I'll have to drop by and see if we can go in and take a look at how he makes his paintings. Well, we're out here in Williamsburg. We're gonna drop in for a studio visit. James Little.
We don't have much in here now. The painting. Wait.
Well, I wanted to thank you for taking some time to let us come out and visit the studio and see what you're You doing out here where the dirty work takes place?
Yeah, this is where, let me turn those lights on. This is where the dirty work takes place.
Well, I was also very interested, and I think our viewers would like to see a little bit about your practice. You know, you're actually pretty well known as someone that's been using encaustic and kind of a, I guess what you'd call a classic painting technique.
Yeah.
Can you tell us a little bit about this? Oh, I like your extended brushes. Now, here's your hot plates.
Yeah.
And each one of these buckets has got
a different color in it.
Batch of paint in there.
Yeah. Right. Each one.
So what kind of wax do you use? Do you use mainly beeswax?
Yeah, I use beeswax. And
you don't have to tell us about everything about the secret formula, but you use beeswax. What else? Varnish?
I use
stand
varnish.
Oil, any of those other things?
I use stand oil to keep the stand oil is applied first so that the container, nothing burns. If you put wax in a hot container, it burns.
Really? And the stand oil keeps it from burning?
It, yeah. You know, it gives it a lubricant. And
something to saute the wax in.
Yeah. But the wax is tricky, and pigments are tricky, so you know, you have to make adjustments as you go along.
Now, you're using mostly powdered pigment that you
use
with this?
No, I don't use powdered pigment here. No, I those works on paper of powdered pigment.
So you're using actual oil out of the tube that you squirt into the...
Yeah.
Into your mixture of the hot wax.
Yeah. All this stuff is different, you know. It's cobalt, and then I got turquoise, and I got turquoise light, I got cobalt blue, ultramarine, cadmium, I got ochres.
You got the nasty stuff, the cadmiums and the yellows and reds and oranges.
But you see those respirators?
Yeah, I do.
I got a bunch of respirators, so I pretty much, I don't take any risk with this stuff. And
good. And did you also know Clement Greenberg as well?
Sure did. When I was at Syracuse, I had some seminars with Greenberg.
And would you say that he's influenced your practice, or do you still sort of think about him and consider him relevant to what you're doing?
Yeah, he is relevant. He probably always will be. I mean, I like his writing. I like his a lot of his opinions about modern painting. And I like some of the questions that he raised regarding abstract painting. And I like some of the things that he said regarding American art.
And, yes.
You know, so I think the big... the big dilemma today is in American art, because most of what's been sanctioned these past, I would say this past 20 years has been mostly from a Eurocentric bent.
Okay.
So,
a lot of the Germans, Italians, and...
Yeah, Germans, Italians, and
some of the French.
Germans and Italians, a few French, but Germans and Italians.
Right.
And, you know, everybody, British... but American painting hadn't been spoken about that much, and so what we're trying to do is really break new ground and revive some of the traditions in American art, some traditions that were set by people like von Neumann and some of Kenneth Nolan's early paintings, targets, chevrons, Alma Thomas.
Okay.
And just the different schools of thought that were. You know, you take it to Pollock too, abstract expressionism, definitely abstract expressionism, but it's the culmination of that sort of thinking process that I'm engaged in, and that's what I think is pertinent when it comes to contemporary painting and the types of painting that I'm interested in.
In certain ways, this kind of relates to the kind of rhythms that you might get in jazz or something like
Absolutely.
That, where you have these repeating chords and things like that, and they sort of... Right, as you sort of go along, you change the format a little bit.
And you break it, so
as a
painter, I have to be able to understand that, and I have to have enough alchemy out of my own studio experience to know what to do, to make those adjustments. And also, I'm dealing with a very fragile material, wax. So I got to figure out a way to make the wax as flexible as I can, and to make it as permanent as I can, and to make it as durable as I can, combined with these other issues that I may have with the medium.
Well, we went by and viewed your show, and really appreciate you giving us a chance to come by and take a personal look at your practice and stuff. Thanks, James Little.
Yeah, man. Thank you.
Congratulations.
Thanks, man.
Thanks, Kate.